Time. We're having a lot of fun doing this this afternoon, as you can tell. For those of you who are following on Twitter, the hashtag again is #UKSG, so do feel free to tweet your responses to the answers that you get this afternoon. And just a reminder, as always, the panel have not seen any of the questions in advance, so it's a complete surprise to them, as might become obvious a bit later on. So if we do call your name out, so we'll just ask you just to put your hand up so we can identify you, and then we'll get a little microphone over to you. So if you did ask a question, it might be you. So please take out your questions now, and we might come to you. And just to let you know, Christina does need to leave us at 4 o'clock. She's got a flight back to Finland, so if you see her sneaking off at 4 o'clock, that's where Christina's going. Okay, so I think we're ready then for our first question this afternoon. So our first question comes from Lorraine Estelle from GIST Collection. So Lorraine's right at the back, so if we can give a microphone to Lorraine. Lorraine, your question, please.
Thank you. This is really more aimed at the speakers from this morning's session. And I'm hoping they can tell us a bit about the IP challenges that face organisations and institutions that are collaborating in shared services, and perhaps a bit about how those challenges might be addressed.
Okay, the IP, the intellectual property challenges facing institutions and organisations. So, who would like to take that one first of all? Colin or Colin? I'll go to Colin. Colin probably has a view on this. So Colin.
Well, I was just trying to think what my view was actually.
Sure. The IP challenges facing organisations as we look at shared services.
I was going to say the shared services I've set up that actually hasn't been a problem, but I can see it might be in some of the other shared services. And I'm just trying to. I think probably one has to actually define how one, simply define and agree how one is going to deal with it. I know that's not a very good answer, but that's the immediate thought I have.
Okay, Ken, do you want to jump in there?
I'll ask all my questions to you as we agree.
I don't have an answer, but I think one of the most interesting ideas around at the moment is Eric Hellman. If you go to the blog, go to Hellman. has this whole project about ungluing ebooks. And he's worked out some ways of saying, well, how much would it cost to buy the author's rights for an ebook so that it was freely available to libraries? So it's not exactly, so I think what that is, it's an attempt to solve some of that problem. And I think that's his trying to do that. And I think one of the interesting things is, you know, Eric's a bit of a geek and he's gone down and he's tried to find some metrics to say this piece of IP is worth X for you know, a blockbuster worth, and therefore how might we then buy that from that person to get over the IP challenge of distributing that through libraries. I think it's mostly concerned with public libraries. So I thought that's one thing. Go to Hellman and ungluing ebooks is one of the bits of the puzzle, I think.
Okay, Mark, do you want to come in on that as well?
If you think IP issues are hard for things like books and articles, you should try research data, because that's much harder. In the Netherlands, an organization like SURF has been working on that for years now and has made several very interesting reports, but I do believe there are national differences to sort out. But that could be a place to start. We are still struggling with it.
Lorraine, perhaps you might want to share what your experiences have been around this and with GISC and GISC Collections. Anything you want to add to that? We'll give another microphone to...
Well, really, just to say that it is very difficult,
yes.
Particularly when you get into the areas of database rights and who owns what and so on. So I think any collaboration probably, you know, as you say, I think needs to start with very clear understanding about ownership and so on.
Okay, and Liam or Anne, do you want to come in from a Scholarlogist perspective?
No, I think Lorraine's identified a couple of their database rights and things like that. I think Lorraine's identified some there in terms of database rights. I think you've also got issues of data protection and commercial confidentiality. Another issue which is sometimes overlooked in some of these discussions about IPR is just the issue of trust and reputation. If you want people to engage with you and share data with you and allow you to use and reuse that information, you have to be respectful of their data. I mean, bibliographic data does not in itself have rights associated with it potentially, though obviously it does with database rights when it's aggregated. But nevertheless, I think for the sort of service that we're putting together, and if you look at the example of JASP, it's about engaging with the people who are going to deposit data in a service, bringing them along with you. People will necessarily be uncomfortable with certain things. All institutions wanted in JASP to be able to see other institutions' usage statistics. Nobody wanted their own usage statistics to be available to anybody else. And those are the sorts of issues that you're trying to overcome with these shared services. I think you just need to be careful about the terms under which material is deposited. And again, it comes back to something which was said earlier about exit strategies as well.
Yeah. Yes, I think there's certainly something about if you contribute something, then, you know, in terms of sharing, you're only going to get back what you put in. So there has to be a kind of a level of trust there. I don't know if that's something that ORCID perhaps on the individual basis in terms of ownership. Mike, something you want to maybe add in terms of adding rights to IDs and standards around that?
The question of whether ORCID is an organisation that needs to go beyond its remit of creating a unique ID for researchers is something that comes up quite often. I've not heard it come up within the relationship to IP before, but it certainly comes up in terms of signing things and so on. Our general view is that the ORCID platform will be developed in a very open way with a very well-documented API. In fact, that's the first thing we've done. And this means that other people will be able to produce applications that use the ORCID rather than the ORCID organization doing these things for you. I mean, we see that the ID itself and the infrastructure behind it has enough things to do, and politically it needs to remain pretty well located to that function rather than spreading out into other areas. So I personally think that having a rights database that has a DOI pointer and an ORCID pointer and defines which license the data or the work is released under is an excellent idea. I don't think it's part of the ORCID idea.
Okay, anybody else want to come in on that? Anybody else, any ideas about this? It sounds like the answer, Lorraine, is that that there is no easy answer at this point, which is probably what you were... Politician's answer, well, yeah. I don't think we, between us, our collective brains have got an answer for it. But from what I hear earlier, though, it sounds like we shouldn't wait for that to be 100% solved before moving forwards. Otherwise, it'll never happen. So. Okay, let's move on to our second question then, which is a question from somebody with a very similar name to myself, so from David Summers, with a U and an S on it, from Lancaster University. So, David, where is
that's
David?
That's me. I wonder if the panel could advise us on how we could make Britain, and particularly England, more like Finland.
How can we make Britain and particularly England more like Finland? Christina, you would seem like the natural person to go to on this one.
I think the question was not exactly for me, but I think sort of collaboration is sort of one of the key factors. Structures, you need to have very clear structures so that you know who decides what, and you have the right people on the groups defining the services and making decisions. It's good if you can sort of convince the financing bodies also to support you so that you would have some funding. But I think some of the speakers today mentioned that it's not wise to wait for the additional funding. But if you can have it of course helps. But collaboration, structures, a sort of joint aim, you really need to agree what you want to do. I think this is sort of the starting point. There must be a need for that service.
Okay, a joint aim. Ken, a joint aim.
I think part of that is, I don't see a totally bleak picture. I think you're right to single out England, because there is some work going on in Wales, for example, and Scotland, where they are working in a more Finnish way. Cross-sectorally, and I think part of that is, again, the Finnish lesson is that better relationship with their local governments. So I think there are some lights there, and I think this is something that, you know, England ought to be looking out to those good exemplars right on its doorstep.
Okay, Anne, do you want to come up?
My quick answer would be rewrite history, have a single funding stream, and rework your history of collaboration. And they're slightly glib comments, but I think if I've understood correctly, I think you have much clearer unified funding stream at government level, which we do not have in England in terms of separation for, say, British Library funding and HEIs, for example. And I do think, personally, that that is a barrier to some of the elements of the Finnish situation. And in terms of history, again, I mean, I think we talked a lot, and Ken gave a lot of examples this morning of, you know, the history, if you like, and examples, well-established examples of shared services in England. So GIS collections, work by EduServe, etc., all good examples of this. But I do sometimes have concerns that actually that has slightly emasculated other levels of potential collaboration. So alongside those sort of more national areas, we of course do have regional collaborations, but they tend to be quite limited in focus, is my sense. That may be unfair, and I'm quite happy to be told I'm wrong on that. And I say, I think there's a bit of a jigsaw that's missing, and I think some of that is because of other bodies have been there, and we haven't necessarily developed the skills of long-term collaboration that perhaps Finland and potentially Welf, Shedl, etc. are doing now.
So perhaps too many silos in terms of the organisational structure. Colin?
I would have thought that one of the issues with England is actually the sheer number of higher education institutions. So if you take Scotland, then they tend to be pretty well concentrated in the narrow belt around the central lowlands. So in one sense, physical communication is relatively easy. And the number of institutions, I don't know how many it is in Scotland, but it won't compare with that in England, and the same with Wales. So it may be that actually trying to introduce the Finnish model in England would actually perhaps be doomed simply because of the sheer number of institutions, the sheer number of people who actually have to buy into this. And maybe, and I can also understand the regional issues as well, because some of the regions have got a lot of higher education institutions, and they're actually very different. We distinguish, don't we, in England between the Russell Group of universities and others. And who in the Russell Group would want to, you know, have anything to do with some of the others? In a sense, there's that sort of hierarchy. So maybe the approach would be, and perhaps someone will tell me that's already happening, is actually a group of universities to get together, get it to work, and then maybe gradually expand the model. But I think to try and go towards the Finnish model at one go, I think it would be courting disaster. I think it would just fall apart. You'd invest a lot of money, you'd need a lot of money, and there wouldn't be the return on it. So one needs to find another approach. I can understand why regional approaches maybe don't necessarily work, but get a group of willing volunteers together who think they could make it to work, who think they could make it work, get it working, and build on that.
So baby steps, starting small with a small group.
I think so. The baby steps don't have to be very slow steps, but I think it's best build on, create something that works on a small scale, then build on that, and I think you're much more likely to be successful.
Okay, I think there's an important thing to bear in mind as well, which is that for all we institutions support collaboration, they're also in competition with each other, and there is a contradiction there, and I think that, you know, that sometimes stops institutions collaborating as much as they want.
Okay, Christina?
Yes, actually the competition issue, I aim to talk a bit about that in my presentation, but then I ran out of time. So if you are building basic infrastructures for your higher education, for example, I think the infrastructure, it doesn't limit the competition. So individual organizations, they can build their own services on top of that infrastructure. I think you would need to see at the picture like this, then it would be possible to move forward.
Okay, David, anything you want to come back on with that?
No, that's very helpful.
That helps. So, great. Anybody else want to come back on how we can make Finland or England and UK more like Finland, I presume, in terms of libraries and rather than just the country more like the other country? Anybody else want to comment on that?
Can I just give a...
Yeah.
Can I just give a vote to Sconnell, actually, as maybe the making of Finland or whatever? I think that the shared services initiative that came from Sconnell was amazing. I found it really refreshing and surprising, especially that so many library directors seem to be willing to give up OPAPs and ERMs, which until that time I thought that would never be said. So the commitment of librarians through Sconnell seemed to me a huge leap forward. Now, whether without a project to base yourselves around, because I think one of the aspects that occurs in many collaborations is that everyone likes a project, but they don't know quite how to run the services after that. So it's really a question, I think, as to what comes out of the Sconnell thinking, the shared library directors thinking inside that, and either as projects or of how you want to relate that for ongoing shared services of one sort or another. I think that's where the arena is.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. So time to move on to our next question, which comes from a young librarian from Glasgow, who also happens to be the chair of the UKSG. So, Tony Kidd.
Is that young? Okay, my question's about the level of disruption with shared services. I put this question in at lunchtime, and I know Mike has talked quite a bit about that in terms of scholarly communication in general this afternoon. But I was just wondering, although there have been huge changes in the way that libraries work over the past 10 to 15 years, etc., in some ways the basic structure has not actually changed hugely over that period. And I was wondering if this sort of shared services agenda has the ability to move us on from the horse's carriage, if you like, in terms of libraries as well as more widely within scholarly communication, or whether it's just merely in quotation marks a way of doing what we do already in a much better way.
Great. So are shared services a real paradigm shift, or is it just doing things slightly better than before? So who would like to comment on that? Mike, do you want to?
Yeah, I'll have a start. Librarian services are not really my specialist area, if you like. What I did notice from the presentations that I saw before myself is that most of the time interoperability appears to be the last bullet point or the penultimate bullet point on the list, and it needs to be the first, because we can't predict what is going to happen next. We don't know what services are going to take over. We don't know who we're going to want to talk to. So whenever you're building a service, the first thing you should be putting down your list of things to do is saying how you get your data out, how you get your data in, how you talk to each other and communicate with each other. This is what's going to happen. This is what's happening with ORCID. The first document to come out of the technical architecture group on which I sit was a document that said, this is how you get your data into ORCID, this is how you get your data out of ORCID. Because in a world which has an uncertain future, the only thing we can be certain about is that we cannot guess what's going to happen next. So we need to build things that are built to talk to each other. So by all means, use metadata, but make sure it's documented first. And that's all I really have to say on the subject.
Okay, Christina?
Yeah, I would like to continue on this interoperability issue and linked open data issue. I think opening our services, opening our systems, opening our APIs, developing APIs on top of APIs, this could develop some new ecosystem around libraries, new services, new industries, something we can't vision yet. But I really strongly believe on this openness and sort of let our users also try the services, try what they can do out of our content.
Okay. Yes, do you want to come on that again?
I think on a bigger point, one of the things that really struck me about Mike's presentation was if you think about the users, in a sense, they're not the ones being disrupted. So, and as I've been involved in some student interviews for a project on ebooks, they're quite happy to disregard the library. They're not in total, but they're quite happy to look at all these alternatives. And I think we forget that sometimes the end users, they're not the people being disrupted, but the people in the middle. I think it's quite interesting, Mike, saying that the researchers, and it's come out in RIN reports and so often, they're not banging on the doors of librarians and so on to say, please help us. They're getting on with the job and finding routes around that. And, you know, going back to perhaps pre-horseless carriage days in my home county of Essex, there's more horses in Essex now than there were in 1890, but they're not doing the same stuff.
Colin, do you want to add to that?
Make sure I understood the question correctly. I think we talk about shared services, but essentially what you're describing is a growing amount of collaboration. And I guess there could become a stage where you say, well, we've actually achieved about as much as we can through ordinary collaboration. Do we therefore need to change the organisational structure of libraries? And maybe one answer might be to have a library service that provides a service to all institutions or all member institutions, and that would mean a big structural change. I guess one of the things I found that if you're introducing big structural changes in service delivery is one can also start to address, it's an opportunity to address issues of, well, what is the service we should be providing? So there's a great opportunity to actually find out what the users really want. So that gives an opportunity for actual major change, both in the structure, in the way the service is delivered, and the services that are being delivered. So I don't know if that was behind some of your thoughts, Tony, whether collaboration has really got about as far as it could go, and now there's a need for actually a step change.
Tony, do you want to comment on that?
Yes, and I think what I was thinking was that this is possibly an opportunity, along with a whole lot of other things, but an opportunity for libraries and library staff to really change the focus of what they do in terms of going out to the users much more and dealing directly with the users, sort of just be more focused on services to the users rather than to some of the other areas that libraries have concentrated on in the past.
Liam, do you want to, or Anne?
I certainly agree with what Tony's saying. I mean, one understands the impact on individuals and teams and so on of disruption. But I would argue that it's actually critical that libraries embrace the future, divest themselves of activities that are better done elsewhere, more cost effectively, and that what we really ought to be building up is the value-added services that are focused on academics, researchers, teachers, students, as opposed to actually spending a lot of our time on basic high-volume transactional activities that actually the user doesn't know about and cares even less about.
Okay, Liam, anything?
Yes, just, I agree, Tony. I mean, I think that there's an element to which changing the internal processes of an organisation is more difficult than changing the technology that they're using to undertake tasks. And I think it's interesting when we were starting the Knowledge Base Plus project and we had a meeting with library directors and we were talking then about phase two and where we should go, one of the requests was that we put some work into actually looking at where those redeployed staff might be employed in the future. What were they going to be doing once they weren't doing the types of work that Anne was talking about just then?
And from Mark, what you were saying earlier, it sounds like there has to be an acceptance that jobs are going to be different things are going to be done, different processes.
I completely agree with Ken that the disruption is on our side, not on the side of the users. So he used a perfectly beautiful phrase of, what was it?
Infrastructure is irrelevant.
Irrelevant infrastructure, thank you, Ken. And I would add to that a sort of noiseless service. So that would be what we would deliver to our end users. They wouldn't know it. They would probably will eventually forget that there is a library, and I don't mind. Because it's all about the added value that you deliver to the researchers and students in this case. And it's not really important who's behind it. Only when you talk to your funder, of course, that's different.
So it's all plumbing. As long as it works, then you don't really care what happens behind the scenes. Yeah. Okay, let's move on then to our next question. So the next question is from Richard Taylor from Bath Spa University. Richard, on the side.
I think the panel may have already started to touch on this, actually. My point was, if shared services are resourced from central top-sliced funds such as JISC, that doesn't necessarily provide much impetus for efficiency gains, i.e. cost-cutting, at the local level, PG libraries, because it's somebody else's money. Is it therefore preferable to fund shared services from local HE library funds, or perhaps shared services can only be truly efficient if all HE libraries and services are funded by one national body?
Okay, so should shared services be locally funded or nationally funded? Who would like to comment on that? Anne or Liam, do you want to?
Well, I'll leap on this and sort of in terms of my previous job of doing licensing and JISC collections. We were very fortunate. We had top slice money to buy archives and JISC collections, which we bought on behalf of all institutions. Something that we were very aware of in the light of the economic crisis was that we were making decisions at a national level. We were buying things, making them freely available to institutions, and there was a much greater responsibility on us, because that's money that could have been theirs at the local level, and they may have felt they could have spent it more effectively at the local level. So I think that it depends on the circumstances you're operating in. Some, you know, a local institution will want to be able to exert a degree of control over funding, and if you're doing it nationally, then you're doing it in their name, and you have to be absolutely clear that what you're delivering is exactly what they want.
Mark, do you want to add to that?
I think it would be wise to only use additional funding for incubator reasons, so to start a project that would otherwise not have been able to get off the ground, but never for the long-term sustainability and exploitation phase of things.
Okay, and we'll pause just at this point. I know, Christina, you need to go.
I need to be going, but sort of in Finland, we have national government funding for permanent services, and it's functioning well, so I don't agree with you, Mark. Sorry.
There you should go.
Time to go. Let's thank Christina very much for being here today. Thank you, Christina. Thank you. Okay, Colin and then Ken.
Well, I've run an organisation that was funded from top slicing. But it was knifed. And the whole purpose of the organisation was that, A, we would deliver some quick wins and benefits for people in the region, and this was in the Northwest, it wasn't in the university sector. And secondly, that it needed to establish itself, and if it didn't establish itself, and if people didn't see, or organisations that used it, didn't see sufficient benefits, then its funding didn't deserve to continue. Now, the problem was that that organisation actually came to the end of its life, but the funding, the top slicing, actually came through central government, and central government never likes to stop anything, so it got replaced by something else. But the top slicing has now ceased, and the work of the organisation is still continuing. It is being paid for locally. And I think, therefore, that yes, organisations that receive top slice funding should be able to demonstrate their value to those organisations they serve. If they really do demonstrate their value, then somewhere along the line they will get funding when the top slicing ceases. If they don't demonstrate sufficient value, then that funding will stop. Organisations won't be prepared to move money their way, and they will deservedly cease to exist. So, yeah, I think give a life of 3-4 years absolute maximum for organisations to prove themselves.
So, Ken, it can't work if it's centrally funded. It's got to be from the local funding. What do you think?
Well, I think this is a great business model question, and I think the answer is there's a variety of business models. There's a kind of public sector top slice funding model. There's an OCLC membership funding model. Thinking about the Knowledge Base Plus, Serial Solutions is a shared service. So there are commercial shared services on OCLC web. These are shared services which are paid for in a different way. And that's what, I think this is where the cloud comes in, is it enables some different thinking about shared services. That if you embark on a, with OCLC on their WMS, you're involved in a shared service. You're paying a membership fee to do that. If you're involved with Ex Libris, you're not a membership fee, you're paying a subscription to that shared service. So you're buying it out of your local options. And that will challenge, that's competition to national shared services funded through other routes like the GISC or so on. So I think, and the cloud is just a piece, I think, of the enabling infrastructure to allow that sort of thing to happen. So maybe we too in the sector could do what Jeff Bezos does and say, maybe we ought to be providing some shared services using this technology and using, you know, being rather imaginative about the business models we adopt.
Okay, Richard, does that help? Do you want to say anything more on that?
Yeah, I think that some interesting responses there. I was thinking more about the, I mean, I wasn't necessarily questioning that the GISC's contribution wasn't valuable, but it was more that GISC are doing valuable things, but does that necessarily result in cost cutting at the local libraries when the GISC does those things for those libraries that in fact they no longer need to be doing anymore? Certainly in, from what I've seen in HE libraries, the library department is kind of in competition with the other departments in that university. And the last thing we would ever say is, oh, the GISC has done this for us now, so we can now sort of make three people redundant. We would never say that because we don't have the ownership of the sort of money. I'm not sure if anyone else can.
Yeah, so competition between the library and other departments within the university. Anybody else want to come in on that?
I suppose another way of thinking about it is that if an organisation like GISC is doing its job well, if you should be put in the unfortunate position of having to cut members of staff, it allows you to carry on delivering the same level of service as you were previously.
Okay, time for our next question, I think. Question is from Ross McIntyre from MIMAS University of Manchester. Ross.
I wish you hadn't submitted a question. That's not my question. It was written just after the session before lunch, so it revisits the Finnish versus the UK. But it was, I was carrying on with this TV theme. If I ask it in the style of TV's, Harry Hill's TV Burr, it was okay, I can see national procurement on one side has attractions, and then on the other, a more community led initiative also has attractions, and which is better. If you're not familiar with it, then you should now start fighting.
Yeah. There should be a fight at this point. So national procurement or community-led development, which is better? Colin?
I was going to say, look at me. And the answer is, depending on actually what you're actually trying to procure. So can you, what exactly were you thinking of? Did you have something specific?
I think the ground's already been covered, but it perhaps picks up on some of the things where Mark was saying, okay, this system that we procured doesn't fit your job, and you change your job the way you do it, as opposed to perhaps the things that are involved in, just for example, where you say, okay, can we deliver this nationally that takes away a menial task that frees somebody up to do something that's more in tune with their intellectual capabilities?
So JUSP is paid for centrally at the moment, isn't it? So there's central funding for that. If it came down that members had to pay individually and there's no central funding, what do you think would happen? What would be the likely output of that? Would there still be demand for it if they actually had to put their hand in their pocket and take it out of their budget?
If we've done it properly, then yes, I'll take the point. Yeah. But there will be a trade-off.
Yeah. Anne, do you want to add to that?
Rather than financing, I'd rather pick up on the national or community-led one. Yeah. And again, we're pitching these as polar positions. And I'd say, actually, you can have examples. And I think Knowledge Base Plus is an example of that, where you've actually got both those elements. So, for example, as part of the work that preceded the project that Liam was describing, there was actually detailed use case study work involving over 16 institutions with staff from all levels up to director, but also in terms of the people on the ground doing the job. And one of the things that surprised me was that at that exercise, people on the ground were very open around where the inefficiencies were that we were trying to address. So yes, I'm not denying that there are potentially cultural challenges around all these shared services initiatives at local level, but also what I'm saying is I think there is evidence from that example of a realism about actually how the community can be quite open and honest about where the inefficiencies are, and that they'll be quite happy if somebody can actually solve that, and that people won't always necessarily be defensive. So I think there are circumstances where you can get a happy marriage between the two.
And I guess it comes down to looking at what are the commodity core things that somebody else perhaps would do better versus where do you actually add the value, as picked up this morning. Ken, do you want to kind of add to that?
There's just terrific opportunity for community. And I think Anne's made a really good point. Having been involved in some of those interviews and sometimes feeling like I was going to give up the will to live with the detail, but fantastic detail. The community has got great resources. And again, it's kind of a theoretical point, but I much admire the writing of Jochai Benkler. I don't know, he's very much talks about the social economy, which is a lot of it's around open source. But what he's saying is, the technology, and make a technology point, like shared service, like these things, is a great enabler for what he calls the social economy. Not the market economy, the profit-driven economy, not the state economy, but the community economy, where the cost of doing things is so low in some areas that it galvanizes the community to do things. And open source is a classic example, of course, but that's for free. But there are other opportunities. So that's why I think that some of the shared service stuff and the technology is a great opportunity for us to create solutions that aren't going to overtake the market economy necessarily, but there's a whole area which we can do things really well and build on. Exactly what Anne was saying is there's this huge feeling of goodwill that, you know, we do want to solve these problems and we can work together to solve them. And so I do think that there's just technology enables that as well as the Googles and the Amazons. It enables Wikipedia. That's a great example of the social economy. So I think we can do more.
Great. And I think, Ross, you might need to explain Harry Hill to some of the non-UK members of the audience as well.
Now.
No, not now. I don't know if that would be possible. Okay, our next question is an anonymous question from a humanities and social science publisher who shall remain nameless. So collaboration on collection development can be efficient and cost-effective, but is there a risk that individual institutions lose their distinctive focus, that we create identikit homogeneous libraries, so we all become the same? Is there a danger of that with collective purchasing and collaboration on collection development? Mark?
No, I would say the other way around. I think that would be a way to know from each other what your strong and weak points in the collections are, and sort of sort out between all the relevant institutions how you are going to build that collection more sensibly in the future.
Okay. Anne or Liam, do you want to come in on that? We're all going to be the same. Central funding, everything's purchased from one pot.
I think it gives an opportunity to focus on the services which you deliver around that content. If content is becoming a commodity and is easily and universally available, then you just want to focus on the value add that you're putting in place. The MIT, when they made all of their courseware openly available, I think one of the things that they said to their lecturers and their teaching community was, well, this is going to make you have to improve the quality of the teaching that you provide. So you're differentiating between what is available on the web to the actual experience that you're giving the users.
I think one to watch is the Too Cool project in the States, which Ken alluded to, the Mellon-funded project between Cornell University and Columbia University. Of course, both very large and by UK standards very well-funded research libraries. But they're actually doing quite a lot of work around the collaborative collection building. But they're also focusing on areas where one partner is quite clearly much stronger than the other, and they are, as Liam has said, actually building new services around that. So again, I think it's how you nuance it, being very clear about what the objectives are, and being very clear that both partners in this instance are going to get sufficient out of the collaboration, that where there may be overlap, that's not an issue, because actually the project is enabling them both to strengthen, but it may be in different ways that they're being strengthened as a result of the initiative.
Colin, do you want to add, perhaps from other industries? I'm sure there's been the same concerns about losing individuals' identities if it's all centralised. Do you want to add anything from that perspective?
Okay, I think that one actually needs to look from a number of perspectives. One is sometimes the supply market, because if organisations keep on doing their own thing, and if you look at procurement, certainly keep on procuring independently, it can actually create huge costs for the supply market and a lot of difficulties. And there's all sorts of difficulties around quality of documentation as well. Some of it is very good, some organisations it is very poor. So I think that there are some areas, if we're actually going back to procurement in terms of an industry, then sometimes it is best to do things together. But there are other things depending on the industry, where it isn't. So it's a bit difficult to generalise on that. I think in terms of the collections, I was thinking, well, what I would like to see is to someone to actually really a proper analysis of the pros and cons in the individual case, then a decent business case. And it sounds to me that, and I think that would point the right direction. I think that without business cases, then people can sometimes, and without a proper analysis of the pros and cons, then people can sometimes start to do something together. This actually may not going to be very constructive, and may not work in the way that they expect, and may not deliver the results that they expect. But I certainly look for a hard-nosed business case. And then the other side of things that I always talk about is people. And I'm much more interested in the people than the technology, I have to say, which is an issue sometimes. But it's people that actually make things work. So there's got to be the right people who are going to be involved in the delivering whatever service it is are actually going to have to be fully on board, fully signed up to delivering it. Because if they're not, there are going to be problems. And I guess this could apply to collection as much as anywhere, I guess.
Any of the librarians in the audience want to comment on that? Are you concerned that increasingly you're being told what to purchase and it's all going to be the same, or is it understood that it's important we're all distinctive? Anybody got any views on that, any concerns? Yeah, David, yeah.
Well, I think we're all looking for our unique selling points as institutions, and libraries are trying to respond to that. But I mean, my first reaction to this question was, just because we all shop at Tesco's, it doesn't mean we cook the same meal.
Very good. Very good analogy. A little plug for Tesco's there as well. Okay.
We haven't got one in Lancaster.
You haven't got one in Lancaster. So let's go to our next question, which is from Charlie Rappel from TBI Communications. Charlie.
I didn't really write it down properly, so I hope I can make sense of it. I was asking, I kind of wanted to get the view of publishers in the room, as well as what we have of you on the panel, about why publishers don't collaborate more. And I think what really drove me to think about this was the fact that publishers are actually quite light on the ground today. And certainly some that I spoke to didn't really understand why this would be relevant to them, which kind of reflects badly on me as the marketing person for this conference. But I really want to understand why publishers don't think shared services are relevant to them. Is it because they're ignorant of the value that you can get from shared services? Is it a sense of not wanting to lose control? Is it a competitive aspect? What's the problem?
What's the problem? Okay, so why don't publishers collaborate more? Mike, that's the publisher on the panel.
I have to say, I found it a little depressing that there weren't more publishers here. Because my thesis, it might be a depressing one for publishers, that we are just going to end up as being something that chucks Word files into PDF files and then maybe XML, throws them in the direction of people who will actually go and do something with them. And if that's the case, then it's a sad ending for 250 years of scholarly publishing. And I'm ashamed, I'm sorry that there aren't more publishers here, because we are a vital part of the current mix. And why we don't talk to each other? Well, we do, actually. I'm going to defend it, because we do in terms of Crossref, we do in terms of DOIs, and we do in terms of ORCID. So actually, publishers do an awful lot of time, spend a lot of time and a lot of money actually talking to each other and making sure that we have one system of ISBNs. I always find it a little interesting anecdote that the reason why Amazon exists is because of the ISBN, because Jeff Bezos could universally identify a product by a serial number, and there's virtually nothing else you could do that for. CDs weren't an option at the time because they didn't have an equivalent to the ISBN. When people collaborate, great things happen. And we have a number of standards in terms of building systems that talk to each other. In geeky terms, we have things called SOAP, and we have something called RESTful. We have these interface protocols. We have RDF, and we have XML, and we have JSON, and we have these great standards that do enable interoperability. And if you look at something like what's happened to Scopus and Science Direct over the last year, with my Elsevier hat on, forgive me, we have built allowed people to come to those platforms and to build applications that mash up data from other sources with data that's on those sites. So the question is perhaps why aren't we seen to do it as much as we are? And there are very good reasons for that. If you look at ORCID and you saw two or three publishers' icons spattle over the web page, you'd probably go, this has got nothing to do with me. So there's a question of appropriateness in terms of the profile. But why there aren't more publishers here talking with people who are responsible for their content being distributed, I can't answer you that, and I'm sorry about it.
I think it's kind of happened to some extent as well. I mean, when I first was in publishing, sort of 95, 96, everybody had to have their own online delivery platform. I mean, you would build your own. That was the default position. And now it would be a pretty tough case to build your own. I mean, you'd look at Highwire and Genta and Atabon and all the rest of it, and then you'd have to have a very good reason for building your own. So I think there are shared services being used by publishers in some instances, and Counter, Sushi, to kind of to add to that list. But you're right, it doesn't seem to be as high on the agenda as perhaps the libraries. So any publishers or vendors in the room want to comment on that? Ruth, yeah. Microphone to Ruth. Thanks.
Hi. I think you're right, Mike. There are quite a lot of areas where we already do collaborate, and obviously ISBN is a key one of those. The piece that I feel is up and coming and that we're not really looking at the moment, and perhaps that's due to competitive advantage, is around the innovation space. But it seems to me that there's quite a lot of room for sharing projects in an R&D space between publishers. Because ultimately, some of the things that we've seen are where publishers have kind of taken a flyer on an idea, put it out there, hasn't necessarily been successful, or it has been successful and they've leveraged that advantage from that. Where it hasn't been successful and where it has been, then we could share that risk between the publishers much more effectively and potentially not lose much competitive advantage, because ultimately you are offering a better service to the customers, and so the librarians would presumably buy from both publishers who's involved in that collaboration project. So I think for maybe specific R&D areas, particularly where it takes substantial investment, or where you could all throw $5,000 into the pot and come up with something quite nimble and innovative, that would be a really, really positive way of collaborating.
Okay, another comment from the back there.
Hello, Roger Schoenfeld from Ithaca SNR. If I can just introduce a perspective to build on what you were saying, David, around the notion of the shared platforms that publishers that many publishers have moved towards. One of the distinguishing features of almost all of those initiatives is that they respect first and foremost the brand of the publisher itself. If you think about some of the efforts in the library community to take advantage of shared platforms, and here I'm thinking in particular about HathiTrust, but there probably are others as well. Preservation and distribution platforms, where the libraries, in that case anyway, have made a decision that bringing their brand first and foremost may not be the most significant characteristic of the collaboration, and that there may be other opportunities to sort of think think more collectively than just a sort of back-end infrastructure. I think that might introduce some different ways of understanding the different motivations or incentives facing libraries as against publishers in choosing to adopt or shared services or collaborate in certain ways.
Okay, any other comments from the floor on shared services? Yes.
Jennifer Maddock, Bapham Institute. I was just thinking about collaborations and remembering back to when Blackwell and Wiley became Wiley Blackwell and all that one. Speaking as a librarian, you know, we had Synergy, which was a great platform. We had Wiley InterScience, which quite frankly wasn't the same. And then we had to wait years for the new Wiley one. You know, when all they needed to do, why waste all the effort? Blackwell Synergy was, you had an involvement, you know, but it worked. And they reinvented the wheel, and one sort of objected to that waste. You know, it would be great to think that if the same thing happened, you know, they'd take advantage and rebrand it rather than reinvent the wheel.
Yeah. I have to say I did smile when I saw on one of the discussion lists the Bring Back Synergy campaign. It was quite heartening. So, okay, we're going to have one more question, the final question of the afternoon, which again is an anonymous one. So Anne mentioned that the dating agency concept for bringing together various people for cheap and cheerful quick wins. I think actually Mark also mentioned dating in a slightly different context as well. Cheap and cheerful quick wins. How do you see this evolving, and what types of issues could it cover? So the dating agency, how could that evolve and issues it could cover?
Well, I just wonder whether we're missing a trick actually, in the sense of that historically we tended to have gone for the larger scale national projects, and through various means funding has been found or sought for that. But a sense actually of whether there may be small initiatives, to use Colin's phrase, that you know could be built upon, which actually would sidestep, because of their scale and how you approach them, a lot of the sort of barriers that, again, Colin alluded to in his presentation. So very small scale stuff that might give you advantage. So as an example, and I mean, I wouldn't say this is a fully thought through idea at all, and I've certainly not spoken to any colleagues about this, but actually are there elements around the user-facing activities of subject experts where actually you could do some small scale, but potentially quite interesting collaborations between them. And it's that sort of issue where you wouldn't be looking to save money, so therefore the cost of what you're doing at the moment is less of an issue. You don't have to have formal MOUs, you don't have to have formal governance structures, but it may be that the prize you would be looking for is whether collectively as a small collaboration you could do better than you can do individually, so that all participant institutions get more value and new or more capability and capacity from the existing resource. And as I say, I just think it's certainly one that I'd be up for considering as a library director, if there is anybody who wants to engage to see if there are cheap and cheerful things.
So keep it simple, get started, and go for quick wins. Yeah, just do it. Colin, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I'd just say in other parts of the public sector, there's a lot of experimentation with small-scale small-scale initiatives, and the benefit of doing them on a small scale is you can move very quickly. You don't have to invest a lot of money normally either. So it's surprising what can come out of it sometimes. One thing that local government has done, if we talk about a dating agency, it didn't quite create a dating agency, but what it did was create a website with a list of initiatives that anyone could look at and just see what is happening, what good ideas there are. And I would certainly have thought it would be a great opportunity for the libraries and so on to be able to just say, well, this is what we're doing. Just have some sort of short note on what they're doing, what the benefits are, and so on, and sharing that sort of information. Now, the point's been made, of course, that universities are in competition with each other, so that people may not necessarily like to do that. But I would guess that you could create a website and there'd be enough people willing to put some very useful ideas on that, willing to list their practical experience, what they've done. One is for a number of reasons. One is some people want to be helpful. The other is that some people, if they've had a real success story, probably won't want to keep quiet about it. We'll probably want others to know. And I would have thought that there's a pretty good way of getting some decent wins out of that without it being threatening, as I say, without much expenditure. And that would seem to be a very useful way forward. So the question's very good.
Okay. So dating agencies, quick wins. Mark or Mike?
Mike, okay. Yes. Okay. I would say that we don't need dating agencies. I think we need to make ourselves available. If people want to use us, then let's be cheap and cheerful. When we build new services, let's build cheap and cheerful. So when we build platforms, rather than putting out emails or notices on web pages saying, why didn't you come and work with us? You build an API, you make sure that you build your service so that other services can talk to it. You document it and you make it available. This is why Amazon works. This is why various cloud initiatives work. It's because they are cheap and cheerful, because the barrier to entry is non-existent. You don't need to fill in a form. You don't need to get permission. You don't need to get lawyers to look at the contracts. It's there. You check a box. You get a token. You get a set of instructions on how to use something. And this is the way that things work, by lowering the barrier to entry. So we don't need to talk about it. We don't need to start initiatives. What we need to do is to build buildings that talk to other buildings, and the initiatives will follow from that.
Okay. Mark, do you want to add to that?
Yes, I completely agree, but also a fair warning that we've had a lot of experience with this in the Netherlands. And what you see often is that sometimes these initiatives start just to circumvent the hard stuff, which means that eventually they die in beauty. They will not have paid as much attention as they should have to things like sustainability or long-term exploitation phase. I think it's very important to realize what kind of projects are really can benefit from this approach, and what kind of projects you should really take into the brainstorm session again, and really think them through in a way that Colin described this morning.
Okay, so we are going to leave it there. So please join in thanking all of our panelists, Ken Chad, Colin Cram, Anne Bell, Liam Ernie, Christina Hormia-Putinen, Mark Vandenberg, and Mike Taylor. Thank you all very much.